3, 2, 1, magic. Streaming this live on Facebook Live. To those of you who are not in church, welcome this morning. And to those of you who are here, welcome this morning. God, give us grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things that should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. My message this morning is this. Sometimes we have to give up trying to control what we can't control in order to change what needs to be changed. I'll come back to this and explain what I mean. Last month, I began a sermon with a humorous quote from Forrest Church from his wonderful book, Love and Death. Forrest Church said, "People who claim that higher knowledge will free us from suffering are fooling themselves. The hard truth is we all die of something. Vegetarians die. Joggers die. Even people with low cholesterol die, many before their time. One can do everything imaginable to play the right numbers, to change the variables in our human equation, and still life won't check." What Forrest Church is saying here with some gallows humor is that part and parcel of our human condition is the fact that we will face things that we did not choose, that we cannot change, and that are beyond our capacity to control. We may not like it, but that's the way it is. This is true for everyone. There are things we cannot control regardless of our wealth or lack thereof, regardless of our power or our powerlessness, regardless of our spiritual practice. In fact, I'm skeptical of spiritual teachings that tell us that a certain spiritual outlook will allow us total control over what happens in our lives. In fact, that ability to accept the things, to accept that there are things that are beyond our control is probably a sign of spiritual health and maturity. And no matter how virtuous and wise and irreproachable and pure and perfect we may be, there will still be things that we cannot control. Those are a few of the lessons of the biblical story of Job. Tragedy and misery can and does befall the blameless. Following all the rules, dotting all the I's and crossing all the T's provides no guarantee. This week, as I followed the news and the weather reports, it occurred to me that perhaps this was a perfect lesson of things we cannot control. As I watched Hurricane Irma make its way across the Caribbean on a direct course towards Florida, I thought, well, there, that's something that is beyond my ability to control. It's probably not a coincidence that at the end of the book of Job, God speaks to Job from out of a whirlwind. A whirlwind, that's another natural disaster completely outside of our control. On one level, this is true. Fire and famine and flood, storms and earthquakes are as old as history, described in ancient literature and reported about on the Weather Channel. And yet, it is also true that human-caused climate change is increasing the frequency and severity of extreme weather. That heat and drought and storm are growing more pronounced in our days. It's true that rising oceans increase the severity of floods, that warming ocean increases the severity of hurricanes. It's true that shrinking coastal wetlands diminishes a city's capacity to deal with flooding. And to the extent that these challenges are caused by us, the opposite is true as well, that it lies within our power to take steps that would result in some degree of relief from devastation. Not complete relief, that's impossible, but lessened impact. There will always be storms and floods and heat waves and so forth, but our collective choices, we're told, will help to influence how frequent and how devastating they will be. So one valuable spiritual lesson is to recognize and admit that there are indeed things that are beyond our control. But another spiritual lesson is not to discount the power that we do have to influence some pretty big and some pretty important things. It is not power that any single person in this room has alone, but when small groups of people or large groups of people or immense groups of people act together, there can be impact. One of the books that I've been reading recently is Rebecca Solnit's Hope in the Dark. Rebecca Solnit takes an especially hope-filled position when it comes to our power not to control the future, but to change it. Solnit speaks of the future as dark, which is to say unknown, mysterious, and waiting to be born, waiting to be created. She writes, "Cause and effect assumes history marches forward, but history is not an army. It is a crab scuttling sideways, a drip of water wearing away stone, an earthquake breaking centuries of tension." She continues, "To hope is to gamble. It's to bet on the future, on your desires, on the possibility that an open heart and uncertainty is better than gloom and safety. To hope is dangerous, and yet it is the opposite of fear, for to live is to risk." Solnit writes further, "Hope is not like a lottery ticket. You can sit on the sofa and clutch, feeling lucky. Hope should shove you out the door because it will take everything you have to steer the future away from endless war, environmental destruction, and oppression." Rebecca Solnit certainly subscribes to that proverbial theory of a chaotic world in which a butterfly flapping its wings in Africa triggers a typhoon in the Pacific Ocean. It isn't that the butterfly controls the typhoon, but in the chaos of the world, there is no telling what effect an action might have. My favorite example of this involves someone from our Unitarian past, Henry David Thoreau. On July 23rd, 1846, Thoreau spent a night in jail in Concord, Massachusetts for refusing to pay his taxes. Taxes, he said, he could not in good conscience pay to a government that supported slavery. He was released from jail the next morning because his friend came and paid his taxes for him. As far as a protest goes, Thoreau's night in jail was not a success. He did not succeed in abolishing slavery. There was so much in that story that was entirely beyond his control. However, a few years later, he published an essay about this experience. The essay first appeared under the title Resistance to Civil Government and was later published under the title Civil Disobedience. A copy of that essay later made its way to Russia, where it was read and admired by Leo Tolstoy, who incorporated Thoreau's principles into his philosophical writings and his attempt to create alternative forms of communal living. Tolstoy, though, didn't really succeed in this endeavor. His experiments were squashed by the Tsarist state in Russia. But Tolstoy did exchange letters with Gandhi in India, who incorporated Thoreau's ideas about civil disobedience and Tolstoy's philosophies about community into his own movement to free India from British colonial rule, which, as we know, was successful. And then to bring it back around, in organizing the civil rights movement, which led to the passage of the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act, Martin Luther King studied Gandhi, who had corresponded with Tolstoy, who had read Thoreau. And that is how Thoreau, refusing to pay his taxes in 1846, helped to liberate India and helped civil rights legislation to pass 100 years later. Talk about the butterfly and the typhoon. Let me break this down, because this is important. Imagine you were walking around Concord in that summer of 1846, and you run into Henry David Thoreau the morning after he spends a night in jail. I want you to be honest. I want you to be really, really honest with yourself. I'm not gonna ask for a show of hands. How many of you would have regarded Thoreau, if you had met him, just as an impractical idealist? Discounted him. How many of you would think, well, that guy is just being foolish? How many of you might say, I agree with your aims, but I question your methods? How many of you would say, I think this whole thing probably needs to be planned out better? Or I'm worried about how your methods might alienate those who are undecided here. Rebecca Solnit would say that we cannot control the effect that our actions will have in the future, but that it's worthwhile to act nonetheless, because none of us can truly know what power and impact our actions might have. This is another aspect of control, another point at the intersection between control and spiritual maturity that I want to explore. What if, I wonder, what if our fear of failure, or our insistence on perfection, or our need to be in control actually helped to guarantee our failure? Let me explain what I mean by this. Five or so years ago, a group came to the board of the church that I was serving seeking permission to begin a new outreach project. I honestly can't remember what the project was, but I can tell you that it's something that I wasn't particularly passionate about. But I remember at that meeting a few of the members of the board savaging the proposal. Those T's aren't crossed. Those I's aren't dotted. What if this? Did you consider that? And what if it fails? Won't that be embarrassing to us if we launch this thing and then it doesn't succeed, if it crashes and fails? We should only do things if we know they're going to be successful. I remember leaving that meeting and thinking for the first time, I'm not sure if I want to be the minister here anymore. To insist that there be absolute control, to insist that our efforts be perfectly planned, to insist on the certainty of success is to demand something that can never be guaranteed. Paradoxically, it is also to guarantee failure. Martin Luther King's Montgomery bus boycott would have never been supported by those standards, to say nothing of Thoreau's act of civil disobedience in Concord. Jesus, we can't support your plans for this gathering. How are you going to feed all those people? And if people get hungry, this event is going to be such a big failure. I don't think we should do it. There was an editorial in the New York Times earlier this week entitled, Waiting for the Perfect Protest. I want to read an excerpt from that piece. National polling from the 1960s shows that even during the celebrated golden age of nonviolent protest, most Americans were against marches and demonstrations. A 1961 Gallup poll revealed that 57% of the public thought that lunch counter sit-ins and other demonstrations would hurt integration efforts. A 1963 poll showed that 60% had an unfavorable feeling toward the planned March on Washington, where King gave his I Have a Dream speech. A year later, 74% said that since black people had made some progress, they should stop their demonstrations. And by 1969, 74%, 3 out of 4, said that marching, picketing, and demonstrations were hurting the civil rights cause. As for Dr. King personally, the figure who current moderates most readily point to as a model, 50% of people polled in 1966 thought that King was hurting the civil rights movement, setting it back. And only 36% believed he was helping. The authors of this op-ed conclude, the civil rights movement was messy, disorderly, confrontational, and yes, sometimes even violent. Those standing on the sidelines of current movements, waiting for a pristine or flawless exercise of righteous protest, will have a long wait. After the second service today, at around 12:30 or so, in the sanctuary, the new ministry in our church, a new ministry, the Sanctuary and Immigrant Support Ministry, is going to be in the sanctuary making a presentation about their work and asking us to consider, to talk about whether we might like to become a sanctuary church. I have to tell you that every T is not going to be crossed. Every I is not going to be dotted. Thank God for that. Because otherwise it would fail. The reading that I began with this morning was that famous prayer, the Serenity Prayer. I've talked a lot this morning about justice movements and about how sometimes you have to stop trying to control what you can't control in order to change what should be changed. That goes not only for justice movements, that actually goes for any area in your life. Your own psychological state, your family life, your friendships, your community, your work, your church. Sometimes you have to stop trying to control what you can't control so that you can change what should be changed. God, give us grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things that should be changed, and wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Amen. Blessed be. And I invite us to sing our closing hymn of the morning, number 6 in your gray hymnal, Just As Long As I Have Breath. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and sing.